algebraic structures associated to Weinstein universe.
Thank you. Okay, so I really cannot promise to say anything even approximately as exciting as the party going next door. So, okay, so I really appreciate you being here, not there. Okay, so, originally my intention was just to essentially to talk about mainly pure algebra. But still, I see there are some people not exactly in this field, so maybe I need to provide some I need to provide some geometric background. Okay, so the kind of subject which I want to study is symplectic topology of Stein manifold. And from symplectic point of view, Stein manifold is really Weinstein manifold. And by this, I mean the following creature. So you have some 2n-dimensional manifold, which is symplectic. And this manifold, in addition, has the following structure. It has a Liouville vector field. And Liouville vector field means that lead derivative of omega along z is equal omega, which is equivalent to say that the form, kind of when you take a z contract with omega, dual form to z is a primitive of omega, which is so-called Liouville form. So you have a there's some kind of fixed primitive of omega, or I want to think about this vector field. And what is most important, that this vector field is not just any vector field, but it's gradient-like vector field for some, say, Morse function phi, which I will assume exhausting. So it's kind of like, so that it means that a proper function bounded below. So this is kind of quadruple. It's called Weinstein structure. Maybe one technical property, I want this vector field z to be complete, so the flow defined for all time. So it's automatically defined for all negative time, but I want to defined for all positive time. So this is a Weinstein structure, and kind of motivation for this, that if you start with complex, if this is was a just complex n-dimensional complex manifold, Stein complex manifold, then on this Stein complex manifold, which you can see as a affine submanifold of Cn, there is some kind of canonical structure of this type. Namely, if you take, for instance, this quadratic function on the ambient Cn, and if you do, so this quadratic function serves as a potential for certain, for standard Keller metric on Cn, and the scalar metric restricted to this manifold is give us a symplectic form. And if we take and the function phi is just this function kind of, well, maybe this phi capital, and this function phi, which is a restriction of this phi to our submanifold x, is so-called pure subharmonic function. And this vector field z is just gradient of this function with respect to metric which this function itself generates, with respect to this standard Kellen metric on the manifold. So this is so you get, for any Stein manifold, you kind of automatically, as soon as you get this exhausting pure subharmonic function, you get this structure. And now we want to abstract of everything, and you have just symplectic data. So this is a kind of nice object. So for instance, when you deform such structure, when you have two structures which are homotopic, they are automatically symplectomorphic. So you cannot really change the structure, symplectic form by deforming Weinstein structure. And it's open question. Nobody knows any example, but probably there are. If you ask, is it possible on the same symplectic manifold to have different homotopic classes of Weinstein structure, or all of them can be deformed through each other? So of course, if you're kind of coming from this complex background, then this is not a kind of kind of trivially true if they come from the same J, because all plurisubharmonic functions homotopic, and therefore you get this always the same. But kind of in principle, this, if you, in this abstract setup, you have, can have something different. But there was quite a lot of kind of subtle work in recent years, starting from some work of Zelda Smith and also Mark McLean, where some other people, me including, were, was a, constructed a lot of examples which say show that, for instance, you can on R to N, you can construct really different Weinstein structure, which is not homotopic to the standard symplectic standard kind of structure on CN, and moreover, even kind of not symplectic morphic to it. Okay, so now as soon as you have this Weinstein structure, you have this presentation, and this is what for me important. You have a kind of symplectic handle body presentation. So for every critical point, you can consider stable manifold, which consists of the Z trajectories, and this stable manifold always isotropic. This is kind of simple lemma. And so in particular, at most they are Lagrangian, and so therefore at most you have this kind of in the critical points of index n. And so you have this kind of picture as in differential topology, that you're building your manifold by attaching the handles which are have this isotropic or at most Lagrangian core attached along spheres which are Legendrian or isotropic, if it have a smaller dimension, with respect to kind of canonical context structure defined on the level set. By the way, I didn't say that. If you have any level set of this function phi, then automatically on this level set you have a context structure, because if you take this form lambda, which is a kind of Liouville form, and then the condition that Z transversal to the level set is just equivalent to the fact that this form is a contact form on this hypersurface. Okay, so we have this, and then also you can do some kind of standard, more theoretic work in this case. And for instance, it's very easy to always arrange change by deform the critical deform the function in this class, that all critical form or the function critical points are self-indexed. So first we have a critical one smaller index and then higher index. And so kind of what is important that we have some kind of part where you don't have a critical points of index n. So I call this subcritical part. Then this is, say, boundary level set which bounds this. And then the whole manifold you get by, well, you can say, assume, say, simultaneously. Well, of course, in general, you don't need to have a finitely many critical points. Let's, for today talk, assume this. And so you have this picture of this manifold. So what is kind of known, that when you have this subcritical manifold, this subcritical manifold is a pure topological creature. So which precisely means that if you have a two subcritical manifold, and if these two subcritical manifolds diffeomorphic and say a symplectic form just homotopic as almost complex structure in the same almost complex class, then they are symplectomorphic and this corresponding structure are homotopic. So it's really nothing there, nothing beyond topology. No, that's no. I'm not assuming that is what's called. Nice. Perfect. No, I don't not assume anything perfect. Yes. No, but it's already not changed. If this handle killing something, it's changed only after I touch this handle, not before.
Yeah, but there's
I don't understand.
So he's saying the subcritical case is not well-defined.
I am not saying that. Right. So of course, you can take say CN, take function with only one minimum, or you can create two critical points of index n minus one and n, and then subcritical part will be some homotopic equivalent to say n minus one. That's fine. I'm not saying anything. But I'm saying if you take the subcritical manifold and forget about everything, and just so let's just study subcritical manifold. So study this Weinstein manifold where you prohibit critical points of index n. Then I said this is a kind of not interesting symplectically object. So for instance, like you can corollary of this thing, and there is some kind of subject of relation of this back to complex analytic theory and kind of. Where you can kind of go back from Weinstein to Stein, and then this statement about some kind of triviality of symplectic topology, in fact, pretty has a quite interesting content in complex analysis. It says take any complex, for instance, take any Stein manifold and multiply this manifold by C, and after that. The new manifold already admit exhausting plurisubharmonic function with just one. What I'm saying? Okay, take say manifold. Well, okay. Suppose you started with manifold which is say topologically R to n, with diffeomorphic to R to n. So. There are construction, and some of them constructed Mark, is that you have a Stein structure on this manifold, such that corresponding Weinstein structure is not symplectomorphic to R to n. But what I'm saying, after multiplication by C, it's automatically is. And so this kind of all this thing is highly unstable, this phenomenon. OK, but anyway. So. What I'm saying here, I just pick this, and this is a kind of topological creature. I'm essentially, as soon as I know topology, I know everything here, context structure. And oh, you don't believe me? Okay. But then where is the whole meat? Whole meat is in this Legendrian spheres. You have a bunch of Legendrian spheres, and our manifold. Attach, so you get by attaching the sphere. And there is a kind of nice situation in symplectic topology, well, in this situation compared to differential topology, that in differential topology, sphere does not define yet kind of surgery, because you need to define framing, you need to trivialize normal bundle. But here, if you want to do it in the symplectic category, then kind of normal bundle have to be, because it's of this Lagrangian property, canonical isomorphic to tangent one. And hence, you have a canonical framing. So this Legendrian, parameterized Legendrian sphere completely defines the surgery. And so therefore, the whole information is in this bunch of Legendrian sphere. So you can say, well, for instance, let's just, to simplify, think that this is a just say just the ball. There is no subcritical point for smaller index, and you're just attaching the thing. So this is an absolutely standard manifold, and you have some Legendrian link in this. And this Legendrian link contains the whole information about symplectic topology, whatever you can dream about. So the question kind of which I'm asking, how to compute, well, any kind of invariant you want to ask of new manifold, knowing something about this Legendrian link. So what I just want to say is that, again, things are fantastically fragile. So it is possible. So like you started with this, and I was talking about this in this my colloquium talk, that if you started with any such link, then you can just slightly deform it. So just to find some Legendrian knot which you get by some C0 small perturbation in some neighborhood, And topologically, as a kind of smooth knot, it will be the same knot. And even kind of formally Legendrian isotopic to original one. And now you also would be able to find some Lagrangian inside this handle, to find this Lagrangian disk spanning this. So such that, well, it looked like almost nothing happened. So you started with this manifold, and then inside the handle, you kind of consider slightly thinner isotopic handle. But now, new manifold becoming completely topological picture. It's becoming so-called flexible Weinstein manifold. You can do it. And then it behaves exactly the same way as subcritical one. So there's no symplectic topology. So there is a kind of, so it's all invariants, whatever you define, are fantastically kind of sensitive to some kind of small thing. OK, so now this, what are the invariants? So kind of the one well-known invariant of which you would like to compute for symplectic manifold is called symplectic homology. So this was originally defined by Flohr and Hofer. And I don't know actually how Helmut thought about this, but kind of when I first heard from him about symplectic homology, kind of I thought about this, that kind of the whole really strange. So it was defined to kind of to find some subtle invariance of symplectic domain. And so and the whole kind of strength of this was in not just that homology had some kind of filtration, and this really filtration had all kind of meat. But then and for instance, if you like for R2n, if you would take the whole space and consider symplectic homology, they would be trivial. And but then kind of like was a for me surprise. I don't know what was for Helmut, but Claude Viterbo kind of somehow observed that if you say do it for cotangent bundles, then it's already, even you ignore completely filtration, that is already not so trivial as, for instance, a homology of free loop space. So did you know anything?
Yeah, we wrote a paper together. Yeah, so I think, yeah, more or less, we had a paper before that.
So you knew this?
Yeah.
OK.
I thought it was.
Okay. OK. Well, yes, yeah, I also have this idea that it's not interesting. But then
yeah,
somehow
so,
it's then
it
now
it's got interesting.
Yes. OK, well, in any case. So fine. So now I will define symplectic homology. I will define this now. But I will define it kind of different way, not like it was originally defined. And this is a kind of definition a la Bourgeois-Onche, which kind of I like and kind of in which I expect use with my construction. And I should say that there is a kind of terrible kind of indeterminacy in terminology. So I will be defining symplectic homology, which I think at least half of the audience here call symplectic cohomology. And so also kind of like.
I think you can even prove that there cannot be any coherent
homology. And also there is some kind of condition about this what grading and action is, and there is this fantastic division in symplectic world, where some think that action is integral of PDQ minus HDT, and others half think that it's integral of HDT minus PDQ.
I think
that's
a theory. If you make a consistent definition, you have to feel sick at one point.
OK, well, anyway, so kind of disclaimer that my symplectic homology equal, for instance, Zeidel symplectic cohomology with grading, I think, changing the sign or something like that. OK, so. So what is symplectic homology? So you look, you have this manifold, and you have this take a boundary of this manifold. So you started the symplectic manifold, and I think about the symplectic manifold. Now, there is this end, and let's assume that there is no critical points in the end. So the end look like, in fact, the cylinder over the boundary, and symplectically, it look like symplectization of certain contact structure on the boundary. So you have this level set, and I look at this compact domain inside. And why is this boundary? And on this boundary, there is a certain contact form, precisely the one which I told, dual to a Liouville vector field. And then you can talk about Reb orbit. So there is a Reb vector field, which is just kernel of the form d lambda and kind of normalized by the form lambda itself. And so the flow of this vector field, it's a vector field which is transversal to contact structure, which preserves the contact form. So generically, you have a discrete family of periodic orbit, kind of like if you bound the length of period of periodic orbit, then there are generically finitely many. So you have this picture. And then, you have to need some kind of extra, maybe, structure. But under the structure, you can assign certain indices to this periodic orbit. And then you kind of you can consider this kind of space, kind of superspace generated by this graded variable, which are graded by indices of periodic orbit. So this variable is one-to-one correspondence with this thing. So then in order to make symplectic homology, okay, so now I will pronounce the whole thing, and then will be some kind of lie hidden. But I'll say what it is. But anyway, so you take this thing, but then you double. So in principle, and I consider orbit and they're multiple. So there are infinitely many of them. But now you have a two. You make two series. You double the number. You have a kind of the original orbit. I denote check, and then I introduce new generator in the space, which I did not had, and which I will grade with grading shifted up by one. That's a kind of just algebraic. This is a space of periodic orbit graded, and this is graded by one. And then you want to take this space, and then on the space you want to define a differential. And this differential you want to define by looking this kind of cylindrical manifold, this symplectization of our manifold, and for the appropriate complex structure, you want to look at holomorphic cylinder connecting this orbit. So, okay. So first of all, I kind of do it ignoring this check hat, and then I just want to I count this holomorphic cylinder which come in one-dimensional kind of frigid up to translation, because always there is translation invariant. And you for this orbit, you define some kind of count. And so this would be something like people call contour homology, or cylindrical contour homology. So there is a terrible problem with this definition, because d square is not zero. And it's come from the fact that things kind of start to degenerate like this. So this can be remedied by the following thing. So remember, our manifold Y is also bound some manifold X. And here you can consider, for every orbit, you can consider moduli space of holomorphic plane. And some of these moduli spaces are zero dimensional. So it means this plane are rigid. And then you allow to what I call this cylinder to be anchored inside X. So you consider kind of maybe it's not holomorphic cylinder, but it kind of look like some kind of pair of, I don't know, even very pens with many holes. And so, and then you kind of request that this thing is a just filled by this holomorphic plane inside the filling. So kind of this, it's a cylinder, but it's kind of digged in inside. So that's, you consider this configuration. And so you count number of this. For instance, if you have a two such plane here, then it produces you two kind of configuration of this type, different. Okay, so then turns out to be that this is already t square is equal to zero, modulo one things. And this one thing is a so-called bad and good orbit. But I don't want to talk about this. So there is some kind of dynamics, some subtlety, but let me skip this. Okay. Anyway, so there is this. So this is the definition. It would be differential. Will be differential on this complex. So now I define different. But I have a kind of space which twice this. And now, in order for me to define differential, I define by block matrix. So on the diagonal on this head, so this is a check and this is head. So on the diagonal, you have a kind of standard D. So it acts from check to check or head to head, exactly the same as here. And you have a zero here. And then you have some delta, which is the following thing, which you also consider this holomorphic cylinder. And this holomorphic cylinder can be, again, kind of anchored in our manifold. But now I do the following thing. I put on every orbit, I put a mark point. And then on the cylinder, there is a standard conformal structure. And I request that my mark point on the orbit are aligned along the same generator along the cylinder. So this is a kind of cut one by from dimension of the moduli space. And so it's go from orbit with index difference 2 instead of 1. And this is this delta. Okay, so there is it's not, again, quite true. That's only part of differential. And the second part of differential is, in fact, consists of the following thing. You have to look at the split cylinder, kind of broken trajectories. But now the condition, you don't request that this thing is aligned, but you request the following thing, that if you go from here to here, so if you go here and you go, say, from here, and there is another marked point there. And what you want that, so there is a 3 point. And you can say, so let's call this point 1, this point 2, 3. And I want them to be in the order, if I denote it this way, I want to be in the order 1, 3, 2. So kind of, well, some. So if they happen to be in different order, I don't count this. So that's kind of the thing. OK. So then you get the thing. And then this d square is equal to zero, and corresponding homology is called if you consider this d with this matrix and consider homology of this complex, it's called SH plus. It's not quite symplectic homology; it's called SH plus homology. And now, in order to get this, what is called symplectic homology, you add to this just you take a Morse complex of function minus phi. We have this function on this one, Morse function on x. And take a Morse complex of function minus phi. And so now you take a sum of this and this sh plus. And there is, again, you define differential. And differential here is, I already defined differential. Here is just Morse homology differential. And there is some term which going from sh plus to Morse, which count holomorphic, like in this picture, it counts the following configuration. You have a holomorphic plane plus gradient trajectory going to the corresponding critical point. So, okay, well, anyway. So this is definition, one of the definition or equivalent definition of symplectic homology. It doesn't matter. Okay, but you don't really need to know what symplectic homology is. There's only kind of my, I think one thing is useful to remember, that they somehow generated by periodic orbit of the reflector field. So now, Now I want to answer this question, what is how to compute in terms of this Legendre data, how to compute symplectic homology. And again, to simplify things, I just assume that there's only one handle. It's kind of, it's almost the same, but somehow it's slightly more involved. But suppose you have just one handle you have. So you have this one Legendre node, lambda. And with this Legendre node, in its turn, you can, in a kind of similar spirit, associate certain algebraic structure. So I'll start with following the certain Legendrian homology algebra, I will call, of this node, which I will just denote by the letter A. So this is the algebra in the spirit of the symplectic field theory. It we define it with Helmut and Guvental, and also it was a kind of independently defined by Chikanov in some special situation. And it's kind of defined similar way. Now you have our contact manifold, and you have this Legendrian submanifold, and in simplicization, you have this Lagrangian cylinder over this one. And now, instead of this holomorphic cylinders, you're trying to consider holomorphic strips, kind of which going between two chords in this rep chord connecting two points on our Legendre manifold and kind of running in this simplectization. So you want to define differential using that. So this is kind of miserably fails, again, by the same reason of compactness. So you upgrade it to algebra. So you say, so now you also consider everything. You consider this pair of pens and this thing. And so your differential now has this kind of linear constant part. It just count essentially holomorphic plane. It has a linear part. It has a quadratic part. You have this kind of, and this is actually always polynomial because of compactness. So instead of this now space generated, you have a algebra generated, but generated by this chords. So it turns out that this symplectic homology of the result is just certain simple algebraic functor of this algebra, of this differential algebra. But then what I will explain that in order to get further structure, for instance, symplectic homology it also have a product. It's a kind of great strength of this thing that it's a ring. And kind of in geometric context, product is given by this pair of pens and kind of related to quantum product in for closed manifold. And so turns out that this algebra is insufficient to recover product. In order to recover product, I would need to look at this kind of Legendre link and kind of upgrade the structure there. But first, let me start with this already, with this algebraic part. So essentially, what I will be doing now, I start with certain algebra. And this algebra, in this geometric context, is this Legendre algebra of this link. So what is this algebra? You have a free algebra, free graded associative algebra generated by this chord, by the rep chord, and it has a differential. You have a differential, free associative graded algebra, and this is my object. And now I will do the following construction out of this algebra. Okay, and I kind of let me explain what this object is, in fact. So you think about the algebra, is it just algebra kind of like in the super mathematic sense? So you think, doesn't matter that it's kind of non-commutative, but you think that there is a certain space where this ci is a basis, kind of coordinate in the space, and this is just kind of algebra function on this space. And therefore, differential is a vector field, is a first order differential operator, so there is this kind of infinite dimensional space, let's call it V, and which is superspace and non-commutative, but on this space there is a vector field. So now this vector field, just you differentiate function along this vector field, and this is our differential. But if you have a vector field on the vector field on some space, then this vector field, you cannot only differentiate function, but you, for instance, can differentiate vector field or differential form or kind of any tensors. So you can take a vector field on this space, and you can differentiate which given by Lie derivative formula. So what I'm doing now, I'm precisely doing this. So let me kind of do it formally. So what you do? So you have this this kind of space V. And now I consider, and it's generated by this C1, CCK kind of this thing. Now I consider kind of new space I will call V hat, where this basis is the same as there, except that I shifted gradient everywhere by one, and added one more vector, which I will denote x, and this x has gradient easier. So I have this space. And now, so you should think about this Cj as a some kind of vector field D or defeat Cj in terms of my previous interpretation. And this is a role of this is, okay, is a little bit different, but let's forget about it. Okay, so you have this thing. And now, therefore, what is a vector field? A general vector field is the sum of this expression. You have a C1, CK, and then say D or DCJ, right? So this is expression with polynomial coefficient. And hence, in this my notation, it will be like C1, CK, and then some U where U is either CK hat or X. Except that I want to just write this on the circle. So I just take it. So I take a circle, and then I have one vertex, which this is my U, which is hat or X, and you have some other C elsewhere. So let's consider the space kind of where generated by such object, by circle with kind of one U in this one. And then on this space, just technically, this is just module over U, which is kind of this coefficient in C. But I want to think about this as a kind of left and right model. So I can want to put the C on both sides, but I can cyclically identify this. So it's convenient for me to be able to write some C on the right, but it's kind of you can put on the left. But remember, everything graded, so certain kind of permutation creates certain signs. So you have this thing, and now on this object there is differential, which is precisely Lie derivative. And what it is, just kind of what it geometrically is. So remember, so I need to explain how it acts on this U C. So on this CI, I already have differential defined in my algebra. So it's add, I'm, for instance, DCI is some polynomial. For instance, say DCI is a sum of some term, and there is some kind of CJ1, CJK. And I just take for each such term, I consider this disk and put this corresponding word counterclockwise, CJ1, CJK. That's for every of this one. And then I need to define what is the differential of the special letter U. So first, I just take this differential as if it were just usual letter. First of all, if it's x, then differential is equal to 0. But if this is one of the hats, I just take a usual differential. But then I pick one of them, one of this corresponding c, and put hat over this. It takes sum over all possibility of putting hat. So if you kind of write formula for the lead derivative, I assert that you get exactly kind of this interpretation. So that's what it is, except that there are certain signs involved. You have to be careful depending on where you put hat, you put certain sign. But this is a definition. So this is a differential, and the theorem that homology of this module is precisely symplectic homology. So symplectic homology is just that. That's how you get symplectic. So in particular, kind of slightly surprising fact that this construction gives you invariant of the manifold which you get after surgery. Because this, you can take different node and get the same manifold. But this depends only on the result and not on the surgery itself. OK. So now I will kind of move to explain some other kind of algebraic structure which appear in this context. Well, and to understand that, you just need to understand that now I took this algebra of vector field, but in principle, I can take algebra of any kind of any tensor, kind of vector field differential form, kind of any kind of valences. Right, and so and then let's see what the structure we get. So kind of you, as I said, you do exactly. Okay, but now first, let's talk about differential form. So this was vector field. But now I want to kind of first have a differential one forms. So differential one form, it's a. Well, you need to have some kind of dual object. So this head were kind of it's standing for d of dci, and now I have a new variable which I will denote head and I put star. So this is kind of similar to in our SFT formalism we were writing p and q's, but it's kind of more convenient this way. So you have this now you have this variable c star. And you also have this variable, new variable x star. So which is kind of stand for the d of. So the role of this cj hat was this d of dcj. And now cj star is a dcj kind of. But d is not that d, the d kind of exterior differential d. So, OK. So now you kind of, what is a. So differential one form, therefore, in this context is again the same thing. You're just writing on the circle, kind of there is a one u star vertex, and you have a kind of everything else here. And now how do you define differential? So you need to explain how you define differential of this one. So this, is, of course, should be kind of dual differential. And you define it as follows. OK, so remember our differential on the previous differential was kind of based on this holomorphic disk like this. So it was dci was product of this. And now you want to apply it here. So now you look at this configuration, and again, and remember, I put some of such thing, putting kind of hat on all possible things when I was defining differential. But now I take the same type of thing, but now I'm gluing it this way. So there is this u star, this is my, And I take, and suppose I have here this U. And then I kind of glue it this way. So now this is a kind of, this is a whatever, some whatever I had before. And this very, on this one, this was a, this was stand for DCI. But in this expression, I put here the CI head star. So that's what how I would define. So this is a really dual differential, if you think what it should be. So anyway, so you get this thing. So you get again something. Well, so now I should say, and what do you get, by the way? So before we get symplectic homology, but now you're getting symplectic cohomology. In my sense, and symplectic homology in kind of some other people's sense, but kind of, and well, in particular, in this case, it's kind of dual object, the isomorphic object by grading. But in fact, kind of, I should tell now to experts. Well, this is a, I'm providing this extremely unconventional language, but kind of like for those who were born in kind of this. When they study in kindergarten and Hochschule homology. So what I define is precisely Hochschule, first of all, it was Hochschule homology of AA, and this new thing is Hochschule cohomology of AA. But it's kind of, I don't like, I don't really, okay, I know the definition, but not no more, so I don't really want to go into this. Okay, so, but now let me kind of explain the product. So I said we can take this kind of differential form looking at this thing, and then you can look at the vector field putting this C hat. But now you consider all poly vector field or poly all tensor field. And what does it mean? That means that you take the circle, and on this circle I put in all kind of in any places, I can put in any order some this Cij hat, and somewhere I put Ci hat star, and somewhere I put x, and somewhere I put x star. And then in between I can put any number of this C's without hat. So you consider this object. And you consider space generated by all such things. And on this space, there is a certain canonical bracket, which is the following thing. So let's consider this A, and you have a B, which is again of the same type. Then first of all, there is some operation of convolution. And this operation of convolution is follows in this written in this order. It's kind of the same, it's a SFT gluing. So I take any of this, and then I consider on this thing, I consider so if I have, for instance, here CI star. And I look, if I have somewhere here CI hat without star. And if I do, then I can kind of concatenate and glue this thing together in this point. And then if I have somewhere another CI hat, I can glue at this point. Kind of I take this, rotate, and glue and consider the resulted thing. And take a sum over all such operations. So this is a, I call it convolution. But then, and then everywhere you're supposed to put certain sign, which I'm not explaining. And then you take AB minus, again, minus plus minus with certain sign, depending on the grainness of B star A, and I call it bracket. And then the kind of claim that this bracket is a really Lie bracket, satisfied Jacobi identity, this kind of thing. Okay. So, this would be nice. But unfortunately, I'm lying. So there's one extra complication. And this extra complication that in order for me, so like on the surface, if I don't care about sign, then this would be kind of almost correct, except that I cannot prove anything about it. But if I care about sign, then I cannot do this like this. I need to break the symmetry. So now I consider new object, where this it's kind of instead of the thing written on the circle, I pick one of these special vertices, either with star or not star, and I underline it. And I call it excited. So one of the vertices, now you have this object, and one vertex is excited. Exactly one is excited. And then when I glue them, when I concatenate, I'm only allowed to glue them if one of them is excited and the other one is not. Doesn't matter which. This affects some sign, but no more. But that's what you change. Okay. So this is what kind of the separation. And now. What do you mean, DJ? This is a kind of pure. This is a pure algebra.
Yes, I understand.
Yeah.
But this would be sort of a picture of something degenerate.
No, but let me go to this. So now I will kind of define some kind of SFT-like creature. So I will define in this. So let's call this U, this kind of Lie algebra which I define. So generated by such thing with this Lie bracket. And in this Lie algebra, I will now define. So now I will look at my Legendre knot. And looking at this Legendre knot, I will define some element in this Lie algebra, which would satisfy the following nice identity. And so which tell me that kind of you have this Maurer-Cartan formula, and then what you get that if you consider D and plus bracket with H, then this will be can be some differential which is kind of equal to. I forgot to say what D is. Sorry. No, not this D. I will write some kind of different D. So this D is the following thing. You take, forget about the special vertices. I have a plenty of kind of this C's, which I call garbage, which kind of spread around and between any letters. And remember, my original differential, acts also on this coefficient. So this D is just my old differential, but only acting on coefficient. It's just pure differential on my original algebra, exactly. And then on this new creature, I deform this old differential by this object. So now what is this object? And this object is the following thing. So you go back to our Legendre knot. And now in this Legendre knot, you consider all kind of not now holomorphic. You start to looking at all holomorphic disk, kind of which arbitrary, which has some number of positive puncture, some number of negative puncture in any way. And there are all positive puncture are kind of special. I'm always kind of so. I always associate with every positive puncture some kind of hat, some star, hat star, with all, and then with some negative puncture, but not necessarily with all. The negative puncture could be here also, everywhere. And with some negative puncture, I associate this hat. And when I associate X, I don't tell you, it doesn't matter. So, but you have this thing. So, you look at this, okay, so now you take this object. And now, take this kind of configuration, formal. Just take this configuration and put some distribution of this and now I want to define some coefficient, and my h is a combination of certain thing, and therefore it's for every such thing I need to associate some number. For most of them it will be zero, but well, I need to. I see that kind of already I'm overstay. Okay. Well, maybe let me kind of let me not pursue this thing. Okay. I am saying that it's a holomorphic. So the corresponding number is a, roughly speaking, is a number of holomorphic disks with this thing. But more precisely, and that's where excitation comes, is the following. There is a one special vertex excited. Well, it doesn't matter. It could be this one. It could be this one. And then I am counting not only holomorphic disk, but I am counting holomorphic kind of some configuration of holomorphic disk. Maybe not one, but many of these holomorphic disks. And such that this holomorphic disk, together with some gradient trajectory connecting them. And there is a certain rule that this gradient trajectory, I have some auxiliary Morse function on my Legendre manifold. And this, in order for me to determine if this gradient, so I don't know, I need to know direction of this gradient trajectory. And remember, I have some preferred vertex. And this preferred vertex give me some starting point origin on the circle, and therefore on the circle I have orientation. And hence, when I'm going around, I once running along this gradient trajectory in one direction and once running in opposite direction. And what I want when I'm running first time, I want to run in the kind of descending gradient direction. That's the rule. And that's why I need this excitation point. Because this configuration may exist with one direction and not exist with another direction. So therefore, this kind of number depends on the choosing of excitation point. Okay, but kind of last thing is the following. So what is the product, and then I stop. So the product is given by the following. It's given by small part of this h. So you take this term h12 and h20. So that means 1 up, 2 down, and 2 0. So that it means that the special vertex 1 up, 2 down, and you have any number of this garbage negative vertices down. And the kind of when you want to define product of two things, then you consider the following configuration. First, you consider my h, which is determined by this type of holomorphic disk, where this thing I request excited. And so I kind of glue all possible things like this. And then to the result, I consider now this type of configuration where, again, some AB where this thing is excited. And now I'm gluing this thing in. And so now I'm applying. So my rule of application is the following. Remember, when I take this my convolution, I always glue excited version with non-excited. So when result of this application, when I do this, it's I will have what I'm said. So this was a x. You have a you have a b, and this thing. Ah, just opposite. Okay. So So this is excited, and these two things are not excited. So therefore, I can glue excited vertex to this one, and I'm kind of left with one more. And then I try to see if I can glue this, if this thing is B. If this is a kind of B hat, like the same thing, then I can B hat star, then I can attach to this. So anyway, I'm counting configuration, in order to see what is the result of the product, it will be sum of C when I apply to my AB this type of configuration operation. Okay, well, sorry, it's already becoming completely incomprehensible.
Thank you very much.